Welcome and good afternoon, everyone, to Ellison's ChipChat session on making American manufacturers world class. We're going to start things off with a little bit of housekeeping. We do have all of our attendees on hold or on mute, but we do want to hear from you. So if you'd like to ask any questions throughout the presentation, we're going to show you on your control panel. Jeff, if you can advance the slide. Oh, there we go. Perfect. So on the right-hand side, if you're on a Mac or a PC, if you click on the questions panel, there's a section there you can type it in and hit send. If you're on a mobile device, that's the picture on the bottom left. It's represented by a question mark. If you click on that, it'll pull up a text box that you can submit your questions. And then we'll have a Q&A session at the very end and go through all of those for you. So as you can see up on the screen here, we've got Mr. Jeff Lage. He's our presenter today. He's Ellison's president of advanced technology, and he's going to go through his presentation of Done in One. So thanks, Jeff. Welcome.
Thanks so much, Sarah. Thanks for everyone joining in today on our continued Chip Chat series, Journey to World-Class Excellence in Done in One. I'm Jeff Lage. I've been with Ellison for about 2 years. And before I joined Ellison, I was a customer for many years. I worked most recently running Dunlop, or B&B Manufacturing for about 24 years. And before that, I was down in the valley at Dunlop and Abbott in Southern California. So I've truly been in the Southern California Aerospace Group for the last 40 years. Let's see, I'm getting a message that maybe you guys aren't seeing the screen. Sarah, are you getting the screen up there?
Nope, we're good. Everything is running smooth on my end.
Okay, great. So so I've been through a lot of changes in industry, from earthquakes in Southern California, to 9/11, several different changes in the economy. And most recently here, again, I've been with Ellison the last couple of years. In the last, month or so, couple months now, I've been working, and you can see a picture at the top of the screen there from my buddy Joe Plyo at Plyo Materials. I've got a group I've been hosting, and I call it Made in America CB19. And a couple of weeks ago, my buddy Dave Fisher had a picture behind his head, Jeff Lage is essential, because we've been talking about what's happening in the industry, what can we do, how do we get ahead of it, and that really surrounds what we've been trying to do at Ellison. It's really, how do we bring solutions to industry, how do we help, this reshoring process, how do we help companies become globally competitive, which really goes back to our founders' sentiment, our mission statement, if you will, about making our customers globally competitive. So as we see these opportunities, as we see the aerospace industry slow down, as we see people looking at other industries, we're definitely trying to find ways. And some of the things I presented here, they really, spawn back on my, 40 plus years in industry. So No Burr Left Behind, we presented here recently. Industry 4.0, is there a cobot in my future? And today, Done in One is a journey about multi-axis turning. And I'm going to share some success stories from a few of our different customers, and also my personal experience that I've gone through. Let's see, we're going to start off. We got a couple of polling questions. So the first one's coming up, and this will let us kind of gauge the group. How many multi-axis machines do you own currently? So the choices are none, 1 to 5, 5 to 9, 10 or more, or I'm planning to purchase in the future. And we'll give you guys a sec to figure that out. So again, how many multi-axis lathes do you own currently? None, 1 to 5, 5 to 9, 10 or more, I'm planning to purchase in the future. And I'm going to tell you a little story a little later here about my first multi-axis lathe and the interesting journey that we had at B&B Manufacturing getting that in place. So,
hey Jeff, if I could interrupt real quick, I'm seeing some attendees that are putting their answers in the question box. This is actually interactive. So on your screen, either if you're on your mobile device or on your PC with your mouse, you can actually click on your answer on the screen and hit submit, and that's actually going to submit to our poll. So don't use the question box for your answers. Actually, use the screen real time and hit submit. Sorry, Jeff.
Thanks, Sarah. No, thank you. Yeah, and then press that submit button. And this is really cool because it lets us know exactly what's going on with the group that's on today. And it lets everybody kind of know, okay, yeah, so this is where kind of industry is. And then we can kind of tweak things as well as we go forward based on what's happening. So it looks like the poll answers have been submitted. So we should get some responses there. Okay, so it looks like 25% do not have any multi-axis lathes. About 50% have between 1 and 5, 14% between 5 and 9, and 8% about 10 or more, in a small group, 4% planning to purchase in the future. So that's great. So that says, really tells us that some of us are using this technology, and certainly there's an opportunity for a number of us to, you know, take advantage of this. So as we get started, I'm going to kind of lay out the agenda here. So done in one, a look at multi-axis turning, share a couple of customer success stories. I'm going to share my personal story, and it kind of gets into our multi-axis at B&B and change. And then we'll talk a little bit about maybe current state, what it might look like, future state. We'll look at kind of an overview of another company that has gone through the transformation, and then talk about preparation and then summarize. So it'll move pretty quick today. You know, these don't take too long, and we appreciate you guys jumping in. So let's just go ahead and get started. One of our first customers, Ron Lowe Engineering, Camarillo, California, sunny California. Rick Slaney, the company has been in business a little longer than 50 years now. They've got about 50 employees, and we're kind of showing a multi-axis part, right? And really, it's all about the part. And as we talked to Rick, and I've known Rick for many years, and talked to him about his journey, he kind of brought me back to West Tech many years ago. And he came into West Tech, he came in to meet with our team, and he was looking at a quotation that he thought he was going to get the award. He'd already quoted the job. He had his numbers. He knew where he needed to be. And so he showed the team, hey, these are the prints. These are the parts I want to make. Because remember, it's all about the part. And so they looked at it. And at the time, Rick's experience was, you know, really running two-axis lathes and three-axis mills. And when they looked at the part, they came up with some really incredible numbers. He got pretty excited. And he purchased his first twin spindle. Multi-axis lathe, but no Y-axis at that time. So he could still do some milling, but everything had to be on centerline, and it really got him going. From there, of course, the journey just continues, and that has been my personal experience as well. He went from the twin spindle with no Y to a twin with Y, and today his machine of choice is the Doosan TT1800. And, you know, talking with Rick, and this is where I really appreciate it, and in my own experience, utilizing multi-axis equipment, right? We'll kind of cover that as we move forward. But if we think about it, right, we run over to the mill, we run the job, you know, we set it up, we turn it into inspection, we got to buy off the traveler, we're maybe waiting on inspection. Inspection could be a bottleneck. And then we go to the next machine and the next machine and the next machine. So when Rick was sharing with me earlier this week that, you know, I put two of them face to face, it's literally like one person running eight machines. So, you know, I think most of us, you know, are familiar with the term span of control. Can we get one person maybe to operate one machine or two machines? Maybe in the right condition, a person can run three machines, but certainly having someone run eight machines would be a difficult task. So being able to use multi-axis equipment has been paramount for many years at Ron Lowe. And the other benefits, of course, is much less floor space. So if I don't have, you know, eight machines to work with and I'm only working with two, I've got greenfield for new opportunities for new business. Certainly, if I'm not going through all these different job steps, right, then I'm going to have increased throughput and efficiency. And, you know, generally my work in process inventory is going to go down. I'm going to free up labor and really allow my personnel to focus more on, you know, the process, you know, and improving the product and continuous improvement versus trying to manage 8 machines. We can really zero in on those 2. So a great story, great company in Camarillo, and a great gentleman running the place. As we swing over to Blue Ash, Ohio, you know, Blue Ash was founded in 1998. They've got about 35 employees, run by Brad, Brian, and Andy. Shout out to those guys there. Mike Sess is their salesman out of Cincinnati. And again, all about the parts. So when during their journey to Dunn & One, when they came to Ellison, they really came looking at a mill operation. They were thinking, hey, we want to buy a mill. This is what we're thinking. And when our team looked at it, we said, you know, we'd really recommend you go a different path. And at the time, at Forward, they were using 3-axis verticals and 2-axis lathes. And generally, they'd slug the part, take it over to 2 lathe ops, 2 mill ops, and boom, you're done. And that might be a very common story. It was certainly a common story from my experience as well. So the first machine they bought was a Puma 2600Y. So no sub, but they got a parts catcher. They put a bar feeder on it. So it allowed them to start to move to Dunn & One, right? An unmanned machine, and really gave them the taste for, wow, we can really change things here. We can improve what we're doing. We can, you know, have the benefit of maybe when we're running on a lathe and we go to a mill, maybe there's a datum structure that we have to transfer from one machine to the next, but now we're doing it all at the same time. So we can really control, you know, centerline dimensions, datum dimensions, true positions much, much better. Today at Forward Technologies, they enjoy their 2600Y. They purchased 4 Lynx 220 LSYAs. And also a Puma GT 2600SY, which was actually one of my first multi-axis machines. So a great story, and shout out to the guys there at Forward Technologies. So I wanted to share a little bit of data, because I always think that, you know, if we can bring things back to data, we can have a better appreciation. It's kind of like in your shop, you know, people can tell you, oh, this is what happened on this machine or this process. But when you go to Gemba, right, when you go down to where the work is done, we start to understand truly what's happening, right? So in the Ellison's market, we see about 10,000 machine tools sold in our market in that fiscal year, right? And when we look at the pie chart down there, the big blue line, about 5,400 or 58% of those machines are 2-axis and 3-axis machines, right? So 2-axis lathes, 3-axis mills, maybe there's a rotary on there, maybe the 2-axis lathe had, you know, 1 driven tool. But it's just kind of surprising, because when we look at the savings, when we look at just the exponential change that multi-axis can make for an organization, and for me, I'm a lean guy. I've been doing this for 42 years. I'm always looking at efficiency. How can I get it done? How can I improve the process? How can I, you know, offer a better service to my customer and of course, have a better bottom line? So it just is puzzling that we see so many people still buying, you know, these fundamental machines, right? I mean, none of us are really, you know, making our parts on bridge ports, but a lot of us are making them on, you know, lower cost equipment, right? And sometimes, and this is some of the challenge I've seen too, is maybe the mindset says, well, I can buy 2 spindles for less, right? But when we start to really look at the process and we start to look at how, you know, the disruptions, the bottlenecks, the queues, the inspections, the datum structure, like we talked about, it just doesn't quite add up. So why? Why are so many people using old technology? And it's a great question. So let me jump in and tell you a little bit more about it, right? So in my opinion, it's change, right? And if you look at this list here, we've never done it before. We've been doing it this way for 25 years. It won't work in our company. I remember my first day on the job at Dunlap and Abbott back in 1985. And I was working on the night shift. And I looked at this process and we were carrying parts across the shop. And I asked the guy who was teaching me how to run the job, I said, hey, why don't we just bring the parts over here? And he looks at me and he says, you haven't even been here a day. This is the way we've always done it. Don't question what we're doing, right? And so if you look, it's easy to start to understand that the change can be difficult. And maybe some of these, you know, come on your list, on your radar with your team, as you start talking about maybe introducing new technology or new things, right? This is a great quote from Mandy Hale, right? Change can be scarier, but you know what's scarier? Allowing fear to stop you from growing, evolving, and progressing, right? So the ironic thing is this list to my left here, you know, why change? There's actually 50 of them. You can find them on the internet. E.F. Borish is the gentleman who actually produced that list in 1959. He was a product manager at Milwaukee Gear. So, you know, if you look at that, right, I mean, 61 years ago, this gentleman wrote that, and it's still very true today. Because why? Well, there's people involved. And I've had the opportunity to work with a lot of different people in the industry and behavioral psychologists and some good friends of ours down at Spencer Shake, Caper and Associates. And Tom Shank shared this with me a number of years ago. And it's really kind of profound. And it goes through basically the change that people experience when we start to bring in change in the organization. So let's look. You sit down in a meeting, you tell the team you're going to bring in a multi-axis lathe, right? Stage one, boom, fear, cautious, paralyzed. We start to go to doubt, right? So now let's say that maybe I'm the setup guy and I've been on a two-axis lathe all my life, right? I might be concerned that this technology, you know, I don't understand how to use it. I don't know how to program it, right? So this is real stuff. And as people start to think about it, you know, they generally start to get, you know, from stage one to stage two, they'll start to move into discomfort and discovery, and sometimes they revert back, right? So change can be so powerful. And the reason I go on about it is because it is a critical part when you start to make a change in your organization, and multi-axis change can be a very big change. So as I move forward, I want to share with you a very, you know, a true and interesting story at B&B Manufacturing. 1998, it was the height of .com. We had 275 employees, 100 spindles. We were literally shipping to our customer, Teradyne, at the time, $1 million a week. I mean, we were printing money at the time. We were making so many parts so fast. I mean, I went down to Teradyne one day, and they said, whatever you're doing, double it, triple it, just get more machines. So we did. We purchased 25 CNC machines, all two axis hoses, by the way, at one shot. And it was kind of interesting because I was managing this project. I'm going through the whole thing. I'm working with the customer. I'm laying the building out. And our founder comes in as all this equipment's being delivered. And Ken Gentry, God rest his soul, he passed away recently. And he said, Jeff, there's a spot right here. And I pulled out the sketch. I said, Kim, we don't need another machine. There's no machine there. He looks at the sales guy, one more right here. And we purchase another CNC mill. We purchased 26 all in one shot. And at the same time, by the way, we purchased one multi-axis lathe. So the story goes on. And just a couple years later, as you guys know, not only at B&B, but across the world, the dot-com explosion took place, right? We went from 275 employees to 150 employees. We went from shipping $1 million a week to $100,000 a week. You talk about change. Oh, my God. We went through so much change so quick. I mean, it was such a depressing time, a challenging time. I mean, you know, laying off employees, people that were hardworking, loyal employees. It was a very emotional time for us as well, right? And at the time, we also decided, hey, we got that multi-axis lathe. We've never used it. Let's just get rid of it, right? So we returned it. Yeah, we worked it out. We gave it back, and we never, ever used that lathe at that point. So when you look at this quote right here, right, culture eats strategy for breakfast, right, Peter Drucker. I mean, it's profound because it tells the story. We were so busy. We had so much work. We had the opportunity to buy whatever we want, to employ whatever kind of technology. I mean, we had a blank check to hire whoever we wanted, but our culture, our beliefs were so strong that we were not going to allow a multi-axis lathe to get in the way of running 25 or 26, you know, three-axis mills, right? And we continue to buy two-axis lathes, right? So there's that list again, just in case you need it. And as we move forward, you know, I've always liked that preparation meets opportunity, the definition of luck, right? So JDAM, that's a program that I was awarded at B&B a number of years ago from HR Textron. And the program just continued to escalate. It really went up and up, and to a point where, I mean, we were delivering the tail housing and the battery housing at a rate of 200 units a day. The picture of the battery housing on the bottom right, when we first got that job, we were just a contract manufacturer. So we did the assembly, the soldering, put it all together, ship it to the customer. It was a great job, but we had two different suppliers delivering the parts, the housing to us, right? So we didn't make the housing, we purchased it because that's where our customer had it set up. And both of those suppliers were working with, two-axis lathes, three-axis mills. They had between three and four machining operations. They were generally, providing price increases to us while we were getting downward pressure, from our customer to reduce the price. And they also, we had delivery issues and logistic issues, one on the East Coast, one on the West Coast. So really it came to a point where I met with our team and I said, hey, I think it's time, it's 15 years later since we had a multi-axis lathe. And our initial response was, we're not going to buy a multi-axis lathe. And as the problems continued and the price increases continued, we finally decided, let's do it. But we didn't feel comfortable. So we reached out to Ellison. We said, hey, look, we've got this opportunity, all about the part, right? We showed them the part. They did a turnkey for us. It turned out great. Done in one, multi-axis lathe. We ran both part numbers. It was such a profound change that when our customers came over, and we had about probably 12, 15 people from Woodward just down the street. They walked over, they watched the operation run, they looked at me and they said, Jeff, we need a discount. And while there was a little jovialness in that, of course, we had a contract in place, they understood the investment that we made. And that was an investment that started to change the DNA of the organization on how we would address parts, how we would do parts, and how we would move away from two-axis and three-axis machining to done-in-one. Before too long, we purchased a Puma 2600SY, and that was another great success story because we took a part that we were marginally successful. If you take the old lean journey and look at, well, we can run some of these parts, and the building's on, the lights are on, but it was truly a loser for us. And the part itself was running a cell. It was a nice lean cell, three machines. One person ran all three, but it was a quick cycle time. So the mill time was longer than the lathe time. So we had two lathes, one mill, and literally all day long, one person would run all three of those machines, and we would still lose money. After they left that cell, they would go to deburr. So when we brought in the 2600SY, we put it down. We met with the deburring team, and there was a gal, Addie, there that worked for us that was doing the deburring. And we said, hey, how would you like to learn how to run a machining center, a multi-axis lathe, you'll still deburr the parts, you learn gauging? And she did. She did a great job for us. And that turned out to be a great opportunity because we took somebody from deburring. We gave them a higher skill set. They earned more money. They were more valuable to us. And we actually took and removed the cost of that work center because now that work center was part of the operation as well, right? So it freed up the operator to deburr the part, inspect the part, and manage the tool. As we continued the success, our customer came to us and said, hey, we've got another part on the JDAM program. It's three per. There's two different part numbers, so it was about 300 a day. And so I reached out to Ellison. I told him what we had, all about the part. We showed him what the part was. And we bought our first TT1800SY. And what that did for us, of course, is it allowed us to use the twin turret technology, but it also allowed us to add a bar feeder in there, the built-in parts conveyor. We modify it a little bit bigger so it can get through the weekend. And we literally went 724 on that machine. We were lights out for a great period of time. And as you guys know, we still have to manage chips and tools and things like that. But it turned out to be a very successful job for us. And as B&B continues on today, I know they've got a number of opportunities like that that have come through this change. So let's take a look at current state. And this might be similar to some of your shops, as we saw in the survey earlier. Some of us are already adapting, some only maybe one machine, but that mill lathe mill, looking at 3 to 4 job steps, the movement of parts, when we look at, the 8 ways of lean, I mean, that's number one, movement of parts, right? And then we have paperwork. So I set up the job, I get it running, my first article, I take it over to inspection. Maybe there's an inspection queue there. They finish up with it, they come back. and now I'm ready to run. I finish a job and now I'm ready to move it to the lathe. I take it over to the lathe, it gets whip moved over there, and guess what? There's a bottleneck there. Then we find out that, since we're finishing these features off two or three different machines, this feature was off, maybe we have to start all over again, right? So the waste and the improvements, you know, beyond just getting it on one machine, beyond just getting it in a smaller floor space, just continue to compound. There's just so many benefits and so many cross-functional things that take place in each one of our organizations every time we whip move apart, and I'm sure you guys all know that out there. So this was, and over the years, one of the functions I have done so much with is a lot of quoting. You know, I've literally quoted thousands and thousands of jobs. And right in our Excel template, you know, that's kind of the nomenclature I look at, right? Mill, mill, lathe, 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 mill, 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 lathe, mill, lathe, mill, lathe. I mean, it just goes on and on, all the combinations. And when you look at, you know, taking all those different ways to get something done and moving it to one machine, it's just incredible the changes that can be done. So one machine replaces several manufacturing processes in one operation. So we've got our second polling question coming up now. And do any of you use the following with your turning application? Select all that apply. So are you using a bar feeder? Are you using a parts catcher? Do you have any inspection automation? You know, that could be, maybe you've got Bluetooth gauges there. Maybe you're using probing inside your machine. Are you using high pressure coolant? Are you using tool life management, right? And so we're touching on these things right now. Please make your selection, press submit. That start to make the process more predictable and also less manageable, right? Or less manned, right? Less labor involved, right? And it's important to consider these things, and we'll talk about that as we continue forward here. And please remember to make your selection, press submit, and then we'll get the answers. But it's all these things together that start to make a very capable job, right? And we've talked about it in some of the other seminars, whether it's done in one or maybe is there a cobot in my future, automation, I4.0. Process control is just a key part to automation. And just make sure you guys press submit, and there we go. Okay, so 77% of us are using a bar feeder and a parts catcher. So that's great, right? That means on that process, and depending on how that looks, right, we are getting a very good value of unattended machining. We're allowing our operators free time to work on other things and get other machines going. Inspection automation, that's great. There's 21% using inspection automation, and 71% using high pressure coolant, and 40% using tool life management. So, I mean, these are truly the tools that make the difference in the job. I remember, I think I was at B&B for maybe a year, and we were running a lot of that Teradyne work, and I purchased $100,000 worth of high pressure systems, five systems. And Ken Gentry, the founder, he came down to my office and he wanted to know what the heck I was doing, buying $100,000 of the high pressure systems. It made such a difference in our job. High pressure does so much, and especially when we're looking at multi-axis, where we're in a lathe, we're using milling cutters, but we're still having, you know, a cutting tool that's got a single point on a diameter at many times. So it allows us to be, you know, really more in control of our process, have a higher CPK, and just have a more predictable process, which is so important. There's one more company I wanted to touch base on, Midwest Churn Products. There's a lot of information on the Doosan website about these guys. There's a great video out there. If you get a chance, jump out there and check it out. But these guys saw kind of the same stuff, right? They looked at, you know, maybe a different way to do business. And I love their logo, by the way, you know, back to CV and reshoring, you know, you see that great American product there, fast quality service, and there's the American flag, right? So out in Gilbert, Illinois, they run two shifts, but the third shift's unattended, right? And the philosophy is really great because really The thought is on the day shift, you know, during the two shifts in the day, we're going to do changeover. We're going to grab the parts from the night before. We're going to prepare for the third shift. That kind of gives some variety to the team, allows them to work on different things. But the really great thing is, and this came from our I4.0 seminar, is their foundation is machine monitoring software, right? And, you know, it doesn't matter so much which one you have. We all have our favorites out there. It matters more that you have it, though, because it provides the voice of the process. And in this journey, and in my journey, and in your journeys, being able to see every day, not a week from now, not a month from now, but what happened in the last 24 hours, what happened today, what happened in the last few hours, because the machine monitoring can be so powerful for you where you start to Pareto out, you know, where the opportunities are, but you can also set up parameters like when somebody, you know, left the feed rate down on the rapid or something like that, right? And so how is Midwest doing this? How are they running two shifts, third shift unattended? Well, they're doing it all with eight TT-1800s, right? So they've got the Doosan TT-1800 twin turret, highly efficient. They've accompanied it with a bar feeder. They've got the standard parts conveyor. And just like 74% of us, they're operating unattended. They've got a high pressure system in there. They've got driven tools in there. And they're using the Royal Collet system as well, excuse me. If you guys aren't using the Royal Collet system or some kind of collet system, I encourage you to look at some of these things. If you're not sure where to go, reach out to our team. We can help with that. And for a number of us, it sounds like we're using multi-axis, we're using some of the tools. So maybe, you know, this is the journey where you start to use more of it and start to bring in some of the additional tools and augment, you know, your processing. You have more capability, get more done, have less downtime. So as we look at future state and just kind of recap on things here, right? So some of the considerations, right? When we look at twin turret technology, there's a lot of benefit to it because we're getting both spindles and the opportunity to cut both spindles at the same time. There's a number of ways we can do that, right? So first off, I mean, we just got a ton of tools available to us now. We can load those turrets up, gang up tools on there, but we can also do things like pinch turning or prime turning, pinch milling or prime milling, meaning that we're turning two tools at the same time on the same diameter, or we're milling two slots on a bar at the same time, right? And then when we add the bar feed like so many of us are doing, and you look at the parts conveyor there, we're truly unattended operation, right? In some cases, maybe the part is bigger than a bar feeder, and we've got a customer here in Lubbock, Texas, that recently, this is Regency Machine, shout out to Ted down there and the folks up there. And their goal was to run 36 hours unattended. So same machine we're talking about, twin turrets, so they're getting the benefits of high efficiency machining. But in this case, they paired it with a cobot, and that gave them enough product to run 36 hours unattended. They ran this for a week or so, and then they duplicated the system. We did the same over. So great solution, and just a thought on a variation on how you might take a high production, in this case, a dedicated part number, and really get that unattended time out there. So some of the other machines to consider, of course, when we look at twin spindle, single turret machine, the Doosan Puma 2600 series, this was one of my first purchases. This is basically the machine that we had Addy working on. We ran square bar stock on it. We produced rectangle parts that had turn features in it, and she did the deburring, and it was a great success for us, and I'm sure a great success for many of you out there. And again, you know, with just a bar feeder, you're running unattended, and this is also a machine we see a lot of cobot applications on. So that's another way that you might run unattended as well, which each one of these solutions, of course, in this case, we're looking at chucks, but we talked earlier about Royal Collet systems or collet systems in general. Quick change tooling, right? So if you're not just running one part, we want to be thinking about how can I go from job A to job B, right? So if we're fortunate enough to be booking the good work and getting the work out there, we really have to think about, okay, how am I going to strategize my downtime, right? And if you've got your process under control, then the thing you might be left with is setup reduction. And we're going to meet on single minute exchange of die. It's one of the topics we'll be coming up with. I posted on LinkedIn recently a cobot where we did a single minute exchange of die of the end of arm tooling and the pallet in 41 seconds. And you can do similar things with your machine and, you know, under 10 minutes, under 20 minutes, depending on how many tools you have to change, if it's organized, if it's strategized, and if it's part of your plan, remember PDSA, right? And finally, some of the big boys is the Puma, the SMX series, right? So we have a B-axis milling spindle, we have single or twin spindles, so we can put a tailstock in there. Even if we have twin spindles, we can still use a drop-in tailstock on the turret. So there's a lot of flexibility. We can have a steady rest, a follower in there. We can put in parts catchers, conveyor systems, and now you can truly take, you know, much larger parts with the additional tool changer that's off to the left here. We can load, you know, anywhere from 40 to 120 capto tools in there. I mean, bring those tools in there. We've got a huge selection. So when you start to think about more complex parts, more features, this is a way where we can really move to setup reduction or even setup elimination with that kind of library of tools out there. So preparation, you know, just like anything else, you know, plan, do, study, act. It's lean, it's Deming, it's just a good way to do your business. So we first start with a planning process, and we talked about that before. You know, Stephen Covey's I think his second step, begin with the end in mind, right? So we want to plan. We want to be considerate when we're starting to plan. It's all about the parts. What are the parts? Maybe look at your runners first, or look at your families that make the most mix, right? Choosing the right solution, right? And then starting to think about, well, how big of a change is this for our organization? And maybe what partners do we need to get in there? How can we, what's gonna go wrong? You know, and remember we talked about change earlier, making sure that you get and you hear feedback from your team about, hey, what do you guys think is gonna be in a way? What do you think is gonna be a problem for us? Because those are really good things to forecast, to look at, to mitigate that risk, to make sure that you've really kind of considered this walkthrough in it, right? Another thing to look at when you're starting to plan on multi-axis is look at your programming, right? Recently here, I did the seminar, No Burr Left Behind, you know? So I invite you again, if you're not deburring your parts of your machine, your cam cycles out there, all of the players out there today have deburring cycles, and there's some great tools out there. You identify the features, you identify the tool, and I mean, literally, you've got your part coming off. And I'm not talking about wrapping corners, I'm talking about milled surfaces that have burrs, that you're spending money, you're spending time, you're taking them to another job step possibly, and that's an opportunity to address that. So if you haven't upgraded your programming software recently, or maybe if you just haven't had training on it recently, it might be time to take a look at that, right? And if it's something just like, you know, my story at B&B Manufacturing, if it's something like, gosh, it's such a big step and we're not familiar with it, then yeah, we can help, you know, in a lot of these cases, we've done the turnkey. We can help you with your first one, get you guys started. We can work on it together and you guys can learn through it and start to move towards, you know, unattended or less attended manufacturing. You know, when I first told our founder, Ken Gentry at B&B, that we were gonna go lights out, he told me, it was kind of a funny story. He said, Jeff, we make complex parts. Lights out is a fantasy. It doesn't work. It doesn't exist. I never want to hear that term again. Now, you know, 10, 15 years later, I would hear Ken bragging to his friends about our lights out operation and how many hours we get in there. But it's changed, and it's a journey, and it's a journey that we're willing to help you out with. And there's a lot of resources out there today from around the industry. And we're excited. We're excited with the opportunity of reshoring. We know it's a tough time for a lot of people right now. I come from aerospace background, you know, so right now there's a lot of people looking for work, and there's a good reason to capitalize and look at what you're doing. If you're already doing some level of multi-axis turning, maybe now's the time to turn it up, or maybe look at some of those processes that aren't so efficient, right? Remember, you know, voice of the process, machine monitoring. I guarantee you, if you're not doing it, if you do it, you'll call me up and say, Jeff, that was just one of the best things that we've done. The data provides accurate information. In my past, a lot of times we'd use ERP system, and those were the estimates, but they were never the accurate, right? So getting the data from Gemba and with today's machine tools, that data comes right off the machine. It gives you very accurate information, right? Look at collet systems, bar feeders, part conveyor, a robot, cobot, right? But really the whole goal in all this is to be more efficient in your process, to move, you know, down that path, that journey of world-class manufacturing, and these are the ways that we can do it. So we have our last polling question before we wrap up here today. And Yeah, so here we just want to know, you know, how can we help you? Can we connect up and look at done-in-one solutions? Maybe you've got done-in-one and you're the 60% that's not using tool life management. Can we help you there, right? Quick change tooling, that's another area on single minute exchange of die, right? How can we reduce the cost of setup and the impact of setup? And then, you know, changes to the current process to support improved flow, right? So maybe you're just not quite sure and it's about the part, and that's where we excel. That's where we can really help you out is, you know, you come to us, you bring us a part, you say, hey, here's my problem, here's my part, help me out. And this is what we do in every market across the United States. Our team is regularly working on solving these kind of problems, and we're just waiting for yours. You know, we'd be more than happy to look at and help you out. So again, press the submit button when you're done. Done in one, tool life management, quick change tooling, changes to current process to support and improve flow. All right, looks like that's just about wrapping up there. And it looks like the interest is fairly even across there, 26% at done in one solution, 17% at tool life management, 29% at quick change tooling. That's great. You know, there's some really good solutions out there that we can help you out with. And then another 29% changes the current process to support improved flow. And I really applaud that. We talk a little bit about inspection processes and how that gets back to, you know, the quality of your part, the predictability of your part, and really your ability to run unattended, right? And I know that most of these presentations, I believe, are online. I 4.0, we cover that, and there's a lot of good content in there. But, you know, reach out to us, and we can help in any one of these areas. So to summarize today, we're here to help. It's all about the parts. So bring us your parts, bring us your problems, tell us what your concerns are, and begin with the end in mind, right? Where are you trying to go? How do you want to get there? Let's always remember PDSA, and we're here to help you make more. That's my email address. I encourage you, if you've got questions, if you want to chat, if you want to talk about done in one, if you want to learn more about I 4.0, or you know, no burr left behind, or any of the topics that we have, I'm here, our team's here, and we really appreciate you guys joining us today on this journey to world-class excellence with done in one multi-axis journey. Thanks so much. Have a great afternoon.